I think we have a whole cadre of faculty that are very talented and committed to really offering the best medical education that's possible in a contemporary fashion. So when I arrived here a year ago, I saw a lot of excitement of the faculty here that really wanted to make a better product. Our curriculum is very good right now. We have great outcomes, as everybody knows, and some might say, well, why change when we already have a good product? But I think that if we don't change, we're going to find ourselves behind the curve and students going elsewhere. So I think we need to change to offer the best in a medical education curriculum.
A key piece of Dean Shoba's vision for medical education at Geisel is preparing students for the new medical practice, not for medical practice as it was in the 1900s, not even for what it is today, but for what it will be in 2020 when they're the leaders in healthcare.
There was a large Carnegie Foundation report done recently. Essentially, people have been describing it as the second Flexner report, and that report clearly outlined the kinds of issues that there are with medical education currently. One is that it tends to make our learners quite passive. It doesn't really prepare them for continuing to learn in a lifelong learning setting once they get beyond medical school. And all of these skills are really important in a changing environment.
So our current curriculum is very content heavy, and a lot of students find it very burdensome as far as trying to remember all those facts. And so our focus should be more about learning critical thinking skills, learning how to apply the information they've learned. There's so much scientific information now that they can't remember it all. So and they have access to it at their fingertips. With all the mobile devices, so this is certainly an important time to change the focus of the curriculum.
Especially as a first year when you're coming in and you don't know anything, it's really hard to be thrown all of this information and then have to synthesize it yourself. And so I felt like, you know, having a curriculum where they helped you bring that together would be really, really powerful.
All medical schools are really responding to that currently, partially driven by the fact that our accrediting agencies are insisting that we provide them with the skills for lifelong learning and that we use active learning techniques, which are defined quite rigorously by our accrediting agencies. We're being required to have student-directed learning.
So examples of the kind of changes we've made are, one, just cutting down on lecture time. We've realized that although we have a lot of topics that we think are really important to cover and for the students to learn, that doesn't necessarily mean that we have to stand up front and say all the information. Then instead, we can rely on our very responsible, really bright students, self-directed adult learners, to just acquire the information without us saying it. And then the really high-yield medical education experiences for our students is sitting down with our faculty in a small group session and interacting about a difficult clinical case.
In non-doctoring, we do a lot of things that way. So it's not just skills. So if we're doing some knowledge-based things, say clinical reasoning, we have a case. We break the students up into, say, two groups of four. We present the case. They get to work in small groups, think about the case, and then debate each other. So there's many ways we have used small group learning in non-doctoring. And we do similar things in our fourth year course.
We've been doing flipped classroom kinds of activities with often case-based or case-driven kinds of exercises within large group settings, as well as, of course, the labs that anatomy's always done.
So what's next in the redesign? What can students and faculty expect? Well, so this year, at the end of the summer, we'll bring to the full faculty a vote about the redesign model. We want to spend the summer communicating about this and making sure that people's questions about the framework model that we circulated in July are answered. We'll have the vote. Then, in the fall and in the spring, the course directors are going to be doing detailed course design and, in some cases, pilot projects to test some of the new techniques we're implementing. That's going to give us the opportunity to bring to the Medical Education Committee in the spring of 2014, newly redesigned course proposals so they can vet it, they can give feedback, they can suggest edits, they can make sure that it's right, as is their job. From 2014 to 2015, we'll do the detailed preparation for implementation.
The curriculum reform is happening all over the country. It's hard to find a medical school that either hasn't been through a reform recently or is in the midst of a reform like we are, is starting the process. And I think it's driven by the many changes in the healthcare system, the way we deliver care to patients. It's now more team-based care.
Change is hard, and I think we all need to acknowledge that. Having been a clerkship director for a little over a decade now in different courses here at Dartmouth, I would say that we graduate students who are extremely competent and wonderful. And I think a lot of our faculty are worried about that. They say, well, what's wrong with what we're doing right now? They are, you know, very competent students, so why do we need to change? But I think as a clerkship director, keeping up with not only just educational trends, but new pedagogical approaches, I think we can improve on the process. We can make these students even better.
I think it's been a very exciting process, but obviously a very involved process to change curriculum and to change the way that faculty have approached medical education for literally centuries. I think it does attend students' needs better, and I'm most encouraged by the fact that I want to see empowered learners, and I think that these new curricular innovations are going to add to that.
The prospect of seeing our students more engaged, more awake, more sort of self-directed in their learning is really exciting to me. It makes the good stuff about being at Geisel better. And so, yeah, the faculty are under the gun, they are busy, but I think this is the stuff that makes our job fun. And so I'm excited about it, and I hope the faculty share that enthusiasm.
But in order to make this work, we cannot do it without the full acceptance, buy-in, and engagement of our faculty. And that's what I'm hoping that they hear, that this is the time now that everybody needs to be engaged and everybody needs to help us with this process.
It's really the faculty on the ground, they're going to be delivering this. That's where the sort of the rubber meets the road, and you can't have a great curriculum without a great group of faculty, and we're fortunate to have that here at Dartmouth.
From a student's perspective, this is really important because this is something that we've devoted our lives to. It's really meaningful to all of us. I mean, there's a reason that we're going to med school, we're paying all this money, we're working so hard. And so, you know, anything that can help us actually bring that into practice, I think is really, really important.